Cedar Bluff Baptist Church. I think daylight savings time has taken its toll here. I know it's taking its toll on me. I'm assuming that's what's wrong with some other people. We have a new one-page back and front directory out there on the table that Jennifer put together for us. So grab one of those on your way out today. And remember to say that. You know, they tell me that from studies that have been done, there are more fatal strokes, heart attacks, and auto deaths in the 6 days after they change the clocks forward like this. I'm again it.
They didn't need to leave it alone.
We might as well. We can have a vote right now and settle this thing. We'll just
leave it like this. Don't change it back.
Just change it for the whole country. Yeah. That'd be fine. That'd be fine. Just settle it. Yeah. I think something might happen. You might want to pray to that end. Anyway, today I feel kind of like the little boy who was in Sunday school and heard about the creation of all things, including human beings. He was especially taken by the fact that the woman was made from Adam's rib. And, you know, he just, wow, he thought that was so cool. Well, the next week, a few days later, his mom saw him lying on the couch, and he looked like he was sick. And he's moaning, kind of moaning like, and his mother said, "What's wrong, Johnny?" He said, "Oh, my side hurts. I think I'm about to have a wife." Anyway, that's kind of how I feel today. Let's pray together. Dear Father, we want to especially pray for all those that are sick and hurting today, where their life in this world has just become miserable, either by their own doing or by difficulties of circumstances and physical problems and all that. Lord, we want to uplift your name and ask you that your kingdom would come and your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. You are holy. You are perfect. We are not. We praise you that for some reason you love us enough to give your only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We pray for a revival that is coming up. Lord, we need reviving. Each one of us spiritually needs to be filled with your Spirit, and the people of our community and surrounding areas need a touch from you to awaken their souls, to convict them of their needs, of their disobedience, of their willfulness. Lord, do it again. Do what only you can do. Change us evermore and help us to grow in grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus, and not just stagnate, but to be an example to others, to be a light to this world and salt to this earth. Lord, we pray for Brother Russell as he will be speaking for us, that you'll preserve him and that you'll give him exactly the messages that are needed, and that he would be revived and filled with your Spirit as well. Stir our community, stir our hearts in Jesus' name, and bless this service as we seek to worship you and honor you, and as these have gathered together, even after losing an hour's sleep, to come and praise and worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right.
Singers, all right,
I
see
Celine. Singers.
Let's get a little light going here.
Yeah, I have singers.
You grab that one right there.
Singers,
Kelly, I got you one here. Oh, there's that caramel. Yeah, just turn it on. You can see too, all right. Got a little bit.
A little bit.
There you go. They should take care of themselves. All right, I think we're ready. I'm ready to sing. First song we're going to sing is Are You Washed in Blood? So everybody stand, let's sing together. You ready to sing?
Thank you.
Is that Lord for?
Treat it all.
Yeah, treat it, sorry, but cause we got the music today. That was it, just three songs. But I do need the little ones to come and play with the solo instruments, so I need a little bit. They come and be ready, so as soon as they play, they come and play with us. Even if they want to play with some rhythm instruments. Grab one, get ready.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for another day, dear Lord. We just thank you for the watching over us yesterday during the storm, dear Lord. Just, Father, just lift up the ones that wasn't as lucky as we were, dear Lord, that just asked that you watch over them, lead, guide, and protect them, Father, as they took through the struggles with the storms. And Father, just pray for this church, dear Lord, and everything we do. Just pray for Brother Russell as he's preparing for this one day revival, dear Lord, that if we would do our part, dear Lord, and continue to lift him up in prayer. Amen. Father, just pray for the service today. Just ask you to go with us and forgive us what we fail. Let us give back what you richly blessed us with in Christ's name. Amen. Mm-hmm.
Yes, we're celebrating the Lord's Supper today, and I'm going to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning with verse 23. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and let him eat the bread and drink of the cup." And let's spend a few moments in self-examination and prayer. Father, I pray that you would shine your searchlight into our hearts. Show us anything that isn't what it ought to be, that we might repent of those things that are failures, sins, anything that is not pleasing to you. And that we might partake of elements of your supper, representative of your body and blood, in a truly worthy man this morning. betrayed, he took bread.
Dear Heavenly Father, I pray, dear Lord, for each one here this morning. Father, as we take this bread, dear Lord, that everything we do here would be in remembrance of you, Father. Just pray, continue to bless us, forgive us, Lord, that in Christ's name.
Jesus said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and eat in remembrance of me." And after supper, he took the cup and said, "This is the New Testament in my blood." As often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show my death till I come. Praise you, Lord Jesus, and thank you for the sacrifice you made for us. May we always be faithful to you and stand firm through any and all trials and tribulations, confusions and difficulties. May we be found faithful in Jesus' name. Amen. Mm-hmm. you. The girls are working. The girls are doing a good job back there.
Amen. Right now, that is history being made. It stopped with Chinese people, hundreds of thousands of them, moving to our cities in search of the American dream. When they got here, they're curious, lonely, and lost. My name is Jeremy Sin, and I help Chinese believers starting Southern Baptist churches for these people. The believers and church planters I work with, their home country is communist and takes a strong stand on atheism. That's why we don't show you their faces or use their names, but you need to know their stories.
Chinese people really are cautious towards Christians and the church. That's a foreign thing to them.
His Chinese brother came to a major U.S. city to attend school. There, he found himself surrounded by tens of thousands of other Chinese people. And when he discovered he was just about the only Christian in his community, he changed his plans. He started the Chinese first ever Mandarin-speaking Southern Baptist Church. And now his church is growing because the Chinese people he meets all seem to want the same thing.
God has opened doors, and some Chinese people made friends with us. Now they gradually bring their friends to our group.
Many big North American cities have 100,000 or more Chinese people, but only one or two or zero Chinese Southern Baptist churches. That's why your gifts to the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering are so important. Because when you give, you're helping to start the first ever Chinese churches like this one, and helping to create first ever gospel encounters.
A lot of Chinese people came here to have a better life. There's more freedom. There's more of everything good in the United States. But real freedom, real life is in Christ.
You cannot see their faces. You cannot know their names. But you can help change their lives when you give to the Annie Armstrong Easter Offering. That's why it's important for everyone to know the stories about missionaries like this one and the Chinese people they are meeting and introducing to Jesus.
So this is North American missions, but in reality, it is international missions because of all the international peoples who live in the United States, especially in the big cities. Imagine 100,000 of one international group in one city in the United States. So when you give to Annie Armstrong, you're really giving to the planting of churches all over the world. Okay, today let's turn our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. It may seem like kind of a different message today, but we use verses from a number of places. The title of my message: Watch out, little piggy, the hunter is after you. The hunter is after you. I believe it or not, there are a lot of similarities between pigs and people. I hate to tell you that, but there you go. In Matthew 8, you had demons allowed to go into a herd of pigs, and the pigs ran off the cliff and drowned. And, demons, suicide, sounds kind of human to me. Pigs and humans. Pigs get dirty in the mud. They love mud. They love dirt. Without Christ, people love getting spiritually dirty. Unfortunately, when you take a pig and you clean him up, the first chance he gets, he's going to be back in the mud. unfortunately, if we just clean up people on the outside a little bit and get them to come to church and get them to wear the right clothes and say the right things, it won't be long before they'll be back in the mud hole of sin again if their heart is not changed. A lot of similarities. Pigs can actually grow a human, they can implant a human organ in a pig and make it grow, and then slaughter the pig and take the organ and implant it in a human being, I understand. I don't know how far they've gotten with that, but of course you know that pigs' heart valves have been used in humans. So, pigs and humans, yeah, actually they say that human flesh and human skin is most like that of a pig. And when people are practicing tattooing, they use pig skin because it's most similar to human skin. So, yeah, it's just how it is, folks. We're a lot like pigs. And I was over at Cannon's Corner, and we got this thing about Mississippi needs you to be involved in Operation Hog, Hold Our Ground. There's wild hogs in every county of Mississippi now. And it's a real problem. So they're going to tell you how to kill them, how to get them. Number one, identify where the hog damage is. Number two, put up game trail cameras in the damaged area. Have you all seen these over there? No? Number three, examine the photos to see where the hogs are coming from and how many there are. Four, choose the right trap size and design. Build a trap with a gate facing the hog trail. Bait the trap with corn or other feed. Let the wild hogs feed inside the trap for a few days until they feel comfortable and consistently enter the trap. Monitor the cameras to ensure all the hogs are inside the trap and drop the trap door. Use your .22 or larger caliber rifle to euthanize the hogs and continue to monitor for pig damage activity in the area. So there are several other ways that I believe the pigs and people are similar, and that is the hogs are hunted and you are too. You are hunting hogs, trying to get those hogs, and you are being hunted by the devil. That's what the Bible says. You are being hunted. 1 Peter 5:8, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. He is looking for you. He is looking for me. He's on the hunt. He wants to hurt us. He wants to kill us. He wants to destroy us. And why would he want that? The only thing I can understand about that is that he hates God and he hates us because God loves us. Simple as that. The hogs are hunted and you are too. Satan hinders us, accuses us, troubles us, attacks our faith, and encourages us to sin. 1 Thessalonians 2:18, therefore we wanted to come to you, even I, Paul, time and again, but Satan hindered us. The apostle Paul was hindered in his ministry by Satan, by the devil. And so we can't be too surprised that the devil will hinder us in our ministry, hinder us in our efforts to do God's work. He'll try to stop you. He'll try to discourage you. He'll try to get you to quit. He wants to hinder you. Revelation 12:10, the accuser of our brethren who accuse them before God day and night. Satan is an accuser. He accuses us before God. He accuses us before each other. He accuses us personally. He says, you're not worth anything. You can't do this Christian life. You're a loser. You might as well just quit. Oh yeah, he'll accuse you. And he'll accuse you before each other. And he'll make you think the other person is thinking bad thoughts about you and negative things about you and hurtful things about you. And he'll get us at each other's throats by accusations that he whispers in our ear. I mean, the Bible makes it clear that he is an accuser of the brethren. Revelation 2:10, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison. The devil likes to trap you and control you. He wants to hurt you. He wants to put you in a capacity where you can't do anything profitable for God. He's on the work here. And we can't fall into his wiles, his devices. We can't be stupid enough spiritually to just stumble into his tricks and his deception. He's a liar. He always has been. That's what he's good at. In Acts 13:8 through 10, there was a sorcerer, a follower of the devil named Elymas, and he withstood the believers, and he tried to get this proconsul that had been saved to turn away from the faith. And then Saul, Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him and said, "Oh, full of all deceit and all fraud, you son of a devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord?" So the devil was at work through this guy, and he does work through people. He works through demonic powers. You know, I don't know about you, but these people who are mass murderers and some guy gets up in a building and looks down and shoots 50 people just for fun, and he doesn't even know, lives, mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, just, that's demonic. And that person is either greatly influenced or possessed by the devil. If they're going to do that kind of things, they're one of the devil's folks. And he isn't a very nice individual. And he is hunting you. Now, why does God allow that? Why does God let that happen? I mean, why would God allow Satan to hunt us? Well, Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, a tree desirable to make one wise, she took of the fruit and ate. She also gave to her husband with her, and he ate. Long time ago, Adam and Eve, basically by choosing to obey Satan instead of obeying God, they handed the keys, the spiritual keys, as it were, to this world over to Satan. We still have the mandate to control the animal kingdom and all of that in this world, but the truth is, this world is not our place anymore. It was handed over to Satan many, many years ago by Adam and Eve. In 1 John 5:19, we know that we are of God and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one. The whole world lies under the sway of the devil. In Ephesians 2:2, in which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. So he is holding sway over this world. He's the prince of the power of the air. And in 2 Corinthians 4:4, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. He is the God of this age who blinds the minds of those who otherwise would respond to the light of Christ. He's bad. He's a liar. He's a deceiver. And he's haunting you. And he's hunting me. And we as believers, if he can neutralize us, if he can get each other at each other's throat, if he can destroy churches, if he can keep the gospel from going out, then he's got all the more folks to keep their minds blinded and to the light of Christ. This is a warfare. This is a battle. And we've got a formidable enemy, adversary, 1 Peter 5:8 says. In Ephesians 6:12, it says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual wickedness in high places. We are up against powerful forces led by the devil himself. And so, just like those hogs were hunted, we are hunted by the devil. Secondly, hogs are trapped, and you are too. You know, as I've said, he's a deceiver. In John 8:44, you are of your father the devil. The desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there's no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. Deception. This world is so filled with deception on every hand. Lies, lies, lies. And now, it doesn't even have to make any sense. The stuff that they're peddling now, that they're acting like we should just swallow, is ridiculous. But, you know, just going back to that same-sex marriage thing, I mean, come on. Anybody knows that God made them male and female. And that's how you come. You're not a baby that has to decide which one you are later. You're a baby, either a baby boy or a baby girl. But these people are believing it. They're swallowing this stuff. It's babies now. And you can't, they're trying to get rid of the personal pronouns, he and she, him and her. It all comes from their father, the devil. He was a liar and a murderer from the beginning. He doesn't have any truth in him. If it comes out of his mouth, it's a lie. And that's pretty much what we're seeing. Just a horrible deceiver. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 11, lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. Even though he's such a liar, he's deceiving so many. We are ignorant. Now those hogs don't have preachers and teachers, don't have a Bible to read. Those hogs don't have a Bible that says stay away from those traps that they're setting for you. Watch out for the hunter. He's after you. But we are not ignorant of Satan's devices. We aren't ignorant of the devil's ways of coming after us, like the pigs are of the hunters. And we've got folks warning us and telling us, and even though Satan's coming as an angel of light, you have been warned. This guy who represents a window company came to our house the other day. He lives in Tupelo, but he covers Columbus and Tupelo. His name's Willie. He's the old tall black guy that used to play minor league baseball. And neat guy, Christian guy. And he said to me, my grandmother had 14 kids, 7 boys, 7 girls. And he said one of the boys, one of my uncles, decided he was a homosexual. And, you know, after that, anytime he came to the house, my grandma fed him. My grandma, you know, said, I love you, son. Love you, son. Said, son, I'm praying for you. Because if you don't stop going away from God and going the way of the devil instead of the way of the Lord, you're going to go to hell. I don't want you to go to hell, son. I'm praying for you. And he said, she didn't just say that one time. She said it every time he came over. I love you, son. give you a good meal today, you're headed the devil's way. Going against God, you're going to go to hell. God wants to know. That old boy was warned. I don't know what he did, whether he ever came back to the Lord, but he was warned that he was going the wrong way. Grandma took care of that. And but you know, the devil uses alluring bait. And he, you know, that corn looks good in the trap, and those hogs just, they just want some of that corn. And it looks delicious. And they're going after that bait. Well, we're about like that. It makes me think of, you know, most every one of those old fairy tales, you've got the old witch, the old hag, you know, and she's real ugly and old, and she's got warts all over, and you know, but she can turn herself into a beautiful princess. And so she turns herself into this beautiful princess, and the prince is going, "Oh baby, woman," you know, and everybody's watching this fairy tale or reading is going, "No, don't do it. No, that's the old hag. She's not really a princess." But he just going for the bait. He's got that, you know, beautiful cheek. He's just going like a sheep to the slaughter. And that's how we are with the bait. The devil puts his bait out there, and we just, "Oh my man, that looks good." We're just like the hogs with the corn. And that's what happens, and that's what leads us to be pulled right into the trap. And the devil tried to bait Jesus that way. Didn't work with him. He gave him some good bait there. He said, "You're hungry, you're starving, and you are God. You can take these stones and make them into bread. You have all the good bread to eat you want." And then he said to him, took him up to the top pinnacle of the temple, and he said, "You know, if you're really the Son of God, if you jump off, the Bible says that he'll keep you from bruising your foot, getting hurt in any way." And then he took him to a high mountain. He showed him all the kingdoms of the world. He said, "You bow down to me, you can have all of this." Now, I really think, you know, Jesus was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without sin. And just to contemplate that is really something. But think of the temptation that he had. He knew he was God in the flesh. He knew he was the Son of God. He knew that he was equal with the Father. And when he was being beaten and his flesh was being torn, he could have stopped that any second. He could have turned that thing around and had those whips going through the air, just nailing those guys who were whipping it. And when he was hung on that cross, he could have stopped it. He could have called 10,000 angels to destroy the world and set him free. He could have called 10,000 angels, but he died for you. He chose to obey God. He chose not to go for the bait of manifesting his powers and overcoming all this and shutting up all the fools and everything. And he went ahead and let them kill him, and so that he could shed his blood for us. So he was tempted, but the devil didn't get him. Unfortunately, we, some of us think we're indestructible. Some of us think that we're so holy and everything that we don't have to watch out. We don't have to put on the whole armor of God. We can just kind of take care of ourselves. It reminds me of the squirrels that I had a problem with in the building up in New York. This building had been sitting empty for 2 years. There was water in the basement, and there were these squirrels that lived in the big soffit in the front. They had nests up in there. I pulled their nests down. They probably didn't like that. Okay, I'm inside the building.
It's just one day drop ceiling and it was just open rafters and stuff. And the concrete block wall came up and two squirrels are sitting there inside the building on this concrete wall. One of them smoking a cigarette. I mean, these squirrels thought they were something. I had a live trap and I was going to get them. But I'm thinking, well, they're watching me bait it. So I don't know how this is going to go. Anyway, I put peanut butter on a piece of bread, put it in the live trap, said I'm going to have to leave that overnight and maybe they'll not be scared and they'll come in. I'm standing next to the trap. Here comes the squirrel. In, grabbing the peanut butter sandwich, bam, he's caught. I'm standing next to him trying to. He thought he was something. Threw that cigarette away and came down there. Some of us are about that bad. Well, you just put a little bait out there and we're gone. And it doesn't even take any trickiness, really. There it is. But others are a little wiser than that, and not like the ones that need to examine themselves and see if they're in the faith and be a little careful about it. But you'll notice on the card here, it says, let the wild hogs feed inside the trap for a few days until they feel comfortable. So in order to get a bunch of wild hogs, in order to get the ones that are a little more wary, you let them, give them time. That's how we are. You know, when there's some bait out there, we decide we're going to have us a little bit of it, you know. God says, don't do this, but I'm going to do it. So we do it. We're waiting for the lightning to hit. Nothing happens. We are emboldened the next day to go and do it again. Nothing happened again. And we get our buddies to come. This is great. It's food. Nothing happens. We're fine. And it says our weight. Watch on the cameras until all the hogs are in there. Then bam! Down comes the trap door. And just like those hogs are kind of tricked into a sense of security.